Good morning, Word of Life family and friends. Welcome to Sunday School for September 13th. The title of our lesson today is Obedient Love, and we're in Genesis 41, and we're going to look at verses 25 through 33, 37 through 40, and 50 through 52. So we're back looking at the life of Joseph. And last week, when we left off, he had just been sold into slavery, and we're moving ahead quite a bit. So let me fill you in on what happened. He got sold into slavery and ended up, he was sold to an Egyptian official whose name was Potiphar. Potiphar was a powerful man. And his wife had the hots for Joseph. She was all over him all the time. And it came to the point where he just had to run away, which he did. And she grabbed his coat, and then she told her husband that he raped her. And so now he's thrown in prison. And he comes in contact with a couple other prisoners. And dreams come back into a play again. You know, we talked about that last week. And so he interpreted the dreams of these a couple of prisoners. And somehow, and you'll have to read it, he ended up in front of Pharaoh. One of the former prisoners whose dream he interpreted remembered Joseph, and he told Pharaoh about his ability to interpret dreams. Pharaoh had been having dreams, and he didn't know what they meant, and all of the knuckleheads that he had around him didn't know what they meant. And so Joseph was quickly taken from prison and made presentable and brought before Pharaoh, and that's kind of where we are.
One. Disturbing dreams, interpretations, verses 25-32. Then Joseph said to Pharaoh, "The dreams of Pharaoh are one and the same. God has revealed to Pharaoh what he is about to do. The seven good cows are 7 years, and the seven good heads of grain are 7 years. It is one and the same dream. The seven lean, ugly cows that came up afterwards are 7 years, and so are the seven worthless heads of grain scorched by the east wind. They are also 7 years of famine."
Okay, so Pharaoh had his bizarre dreams, and Joseph got called to interpret them. He had two dreams. They were similar but different. And Joseph was here telling him, nope, it's the same dream. It was 7 years of, wealth or prosperity and 7 years of famine, not the 14 years. And that's kind of what he was thinking. Seven lean, ugly cows and the seven worthless heads of grain represent a new 7 years. This is the 7 years of famine. It is what it is. So he's starting to interpret the dream, and let's see where it goes.
Verse
28-30.
"It is just as I said to Pharaoh. God has shown Pharaoh what he is about to do. 7 years of great abundance are coming throughout the land of Egypt. But 7 years of famine will follow them. Then all the abundance in Egypt will be forgotten, and the famine will ravage the land."
I think the thing that I like about this, or that I picked up on right away, was that Joseph was emphasizing that he himself was not the source of this interpretation, but rather he pointed back to God. And I think the significance in insisting on honoring God is partially found in some of the ancient beliefs on how the gods ruled, or the way the gods ruled. People were weird with their deities back then. Whenever a person moved, for example, from one nation or to another group, it kind of felt like they left one deity's jurisdiction and had to come under another. But he's pointing Pharaoh to God as a source. And so now we see in 29 that he's revealed specifically what the healthy cows and healthy grain represent. And so we know that that's great abundance for 7 years. But I think it's interesting in 30, it's interesting that he says the abundance will be forgotten in 30, and the famine will ravage the land. So, but we'll talk about that more in a second.
Verse 31 to 32. The abundance in the land will not be remembered because the famine that follows will be so severe. The reason the dream was given to Pharaoh in two forms is that the matter has been firmly decided by God, and God will do it soon.
It's interesting that the Hebrew word translated severe describes something that's too oppressive or too heavy to bear. So he's telling them it's going to be bad. Once again, a repetition serves to emphasize this time. He's telling them the dream is in two forms, and he points them back to God again. It's been decided by God, and God will do it soon. We don't know exactly how long after these dreams the 7 years of plenty started, but the implication of the twice dreams was clear. Pharaoh had no time to waste in preparing for what lay ahead for his people. And again, as Joseph emphasized, God's work in granting Pharaoh the dreams and giving himself the interpretation.
Advice, verse 33. And now let Pharaoh look for a discerning and wise man and put him in charge of the land of Egypt.
That makes sense, I guess. Knowing what the dreams meant was certainly of vital importance, but that plan was kind of worthless without planning for it and using the information. So Joseph took some initiative in making a suggestion right here so the Pharaoh could use that information wisely.
2. Pharaoh's favor. A. Praising Joseph. Verses 37-38. The plan seemed good to Pharaoh and to all his officials, so Pharaoh asked them, "Can we find anyone like this man, one in whom is the Spirit of God?"
Okay. So the phrase "all his officials" likely refers to various administrators in Pharaoh's government, which would have included magicians as well as wise men. Basically all the people that failed to interpret his dreams. But their unanimous approval indicates that God blessed not only Joseph, but bestowed wisdom on the Egyptians that were gathered. And so I think it's interesting that now they're acknowledging God. Can we find anyone like this man, one in whom is the Spirit of God? So that's a big acknowledgement by the Egyptians.
B, promoting Joseph, verse 39-40. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, "Since God has made all this known to you, there is no one so discerning and wise as you. You shall be in charge of my palace, and all my people are to submit to your orders. Only with respect to the throne will I be greater than you."
Well, all right then. So this man Joseph obviously had been given a divine stamp of approval by God, and Pharaoh, I just figured that he'd jump on the bandwagon and follow suit, and why not? Obviously, Joseph was blessed by God. That's interesting. People will recognize the anointing. I always say that. People will recognize the anointing, and indeed, that's what happened here. And Joseph's responsibilities here were very similar to what he had in Potiphar's house, although this is on a much grander scale. But one of the key differences, and I'm glad that it was written in the scripture, was that the only person above Joseph was Pharaoh himself. And so we can really see that God had been preparing Joseph for this position ever since he arrived in Egypt. And we're, as a people, we're really impatient. We can't wait for anything. We want everything now. But it's interesting that what his status changed in just 24 hours. He was a forgotten prisoner, and now, so he went from pit to power in 24 hours after, I think, 7 years of enduring all this.
Three, foreign family. A, sons born. Verse 50. Before the years of famine came, two sons were born to Joseph by Aseneth, daughter of Potipharah, priest of On.
Okay. There is probably some significance here. And again, this speaks to the faith that Joseph had, because he knows that there's going to be a famine coming. And he opts to go ahead and have children. And so that's really a sign of his immense trust in God. So he didn't hesitate. The other thing that's interesting here, and it probably raised some eyebrows of some religious folks, but On was a pagan town, a city in Egypt, and they worshipped the sun god Ra. And so Joseph's marriage to Asenath, the daughter of a pagan priest, that was a kind of a big deal, because after all, her family was devoted to idolatry. And, you know, pagan wives had a way of influencing or compromising their husband's devotions to God. And if you want to read about that, 1 Kings 11, 1 through 6 lays that out. But there's really no suggestion here or anywhere else that she ever influenced Joseph toward idolatry. So even in marriage to an Egyptian bride, Joseph relied on the one true God only.
B, sons named, verses 51, 52. Joseph named his firstborn Manasseh and said, "It is because God has made me forget all my trouble and all my father's household." The second son he named Ephraim and said, "It is because God has made me fruitful in the land of my suffering."
All right. So Manasseh, that sounds like a Hebrew word that means forget. And that's why he named the kid that, because he said, "God has made me forget all my trouble." So, and Ephraim sounds like a Hebrew word meaning twice fruitful, which really reflects on the fact that God gave him not only one, but two sons. The name Ephraim also seems to foreshadow the story of Jacob's family in Egypt for generations to come. God would not forget Jacob, Israel, just as God had not forgotten Joseph.
Conclusion. Firm faith on strange soil.
The God who Joseph served and honored is the God we serve and honor today, one and the same. And no matter what the circumstances, he doesn't change. We know that. So whether we find ourselves in a pit or a palace or an average house, you know, he's there. Joseph demonstrated radical faith in God, even though God might have seemed far away. And I made a mistake earlier. I said 7 years of slavery. I got my seven and sevens mixed up. He was actually in slavery for 13 years. You know, how does your life witness to the same truth? That's a pretty good question, I think.
Prayer. Father, help us be mindful that as you were with Joseph, so you are with us. Strengthen us to great faithfulness. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Lot to remember. Change is constant, but so is God's faithfulness.
What do you think? How useful is it for a Christian to attempt to determine what God has caused versus what he allowed in the story of Joseph? I don't know if it's useful at all to try and figure out the mind of God, because some stuff he does cause and some stuff he allows. But that shouldn't change our mindset, I would think. If we have faith, then our faith is in God, and we don't really need to worry about the reasons for why certain things happen. COVID, anyone? But that's my take. You?
Well, there's a phrase that goes throughout the story of Joseph, which is either, "and it came to pass," or "it shall come to pass." And as we read it in the past of having had happened, we can understand that this is what is going to happen to him. Therefore, we can read it in that aspect of, this is what's happening. It's happening for a reason.
All right. Well, thanks for watching again. We appreciate it. Stay tuned. Bishop will be up next with the word, and that's always good. And we'll see you next week. I don't know how much longer we're going to do this online, but we should hear something this week, I'm told. But we'll, and if we keep doing it online, that's all right, too. So, all right.